Welcome, and welcome to all of you to this evening's presentation of the Historical Society of the Northern District of California. And we're very pleased that you've joined us for what is going to be, I know, an absolutely outstanding program. This is just one of many of the wonderful programs that the Northern District Historical Society sponsors. And we have the privilege and the pleasure of your presence as our guest. But that's thanks to the generous support of our donors and members. Now, here comes the pitch. You too can become a member and a donor and support these worthwhile programs by making a tax-deductible donation of $60 or more, which this year comes with a very, very special gift, a copy of the long-awaited book put out by the Northern District about the Northern District. From its origins, Ogden Hoffman, you remember him, he's on the back wall in the ceremonial courtroom, including stories of the cases and the judges who have been on this court from the time of Ogden Hoffman to the present time. And I'm not going to tell you whether there's anything in the book that will give you a bit of a dish on any of the current judges. You'll just have to get a copy and find out. The book is entitled The Court That Tamed the West. It's published by Heyday Press in Berkeley. And guess what? There are membership invitations in the lobby. I urge you to pick up one or more of them and submit your application and receive a membership and one of these wonderful books, or more of them if you order more. And now to something that's what's really important and what we're all here for, and that is tonight's program. This program is in honor and remembrance of 1963. Many momentous events occurred in 1963, but we tonight are focused on the civil rights movement, movement that was accelerated by the March on Washington, the sit-ins, the demonstrations, and of course, the tragedies in Alabama and Mississippi. And this being November, of course, the assassination of President Kennedy. Our two presenters this evening were present at or witnesses of these events. They're well known to you, of course, for they are members of the bench in this district. One was born in Shreveport, Louisiana. The other only 2 or 3 hours away in Jackson. I'm not suggesting it was in the same year. One was present and a participant in some of the events. The other, a student at Mississippi State University and a keen observer of the historic activities occurring in his state. Both came to this state. Actually, we'd like to say they escaped to this state. One in his childhood, the other after law school. And they fortuitously ended up being appointed to the Northern District Bench. Now, there's no evidence that they met during the tumultuous time of 1963 and the ensuing civil rights movement, but tonight they will relate and weave together their unique experiences. They are, of course, respectively, Chief Judge Emeritus and now Senior Judge Thelton Henderson and Judge William Alsup. Now, I know these people are well known to you. That's why you're here, right? But I will give you a brief introduction, because that's just necessary. Judge Henderson graduated from UC Berkeley and its law school. He served in the Justice Department and was the first African American to serve in its Civil Rights Division. He then served as Assistant Dean at Stanford Law School and was in private practice until he was appointed to the bench, our bench. He's the author of many cutting-edge opinions, and he's been fittingly recognized by a number of awards, too numerous to mention. I had a long list of them, and I would have read them all, but then we would have had no time for the program tonight. He was also recognized most recently for his contributions and achievements by the ABA in awarding him its Thurgood Marshall Award. His recognition is immortalized in the Thelton E. Henderson Center for Social Justice at his alma mater. Judge Alsup graduated from Harvard Law School and the Kennedy School of Government. He clerked for Justice William O. Douglas, served in the offices of the Solicitor General and the Department of Justice, practiced with the firm of Morrison Foerster before joining our bench in 1999. While the author of many erudite opinions, he's also the author of several well non-law related, and I might add, beautiful books. He's a world-class photographer and a High Sierra explorer extraordinaire. And with these two extraordinary gentlemen and judges, we're going to hear about what happened in 1963 and bring back our memories, touch our memories, as well as, I'm sure, some of the ensuing events thereafter in the civil rights movement. Judges, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's make sure the NSA is able to hear us testing. One, two, three. All right, I think we're coming through. Well, welcome again. It's my privilege to sit here and to ask the questions tonight of our honoree and interviewee. And tonight we're going to ask Judge Henderson to wear two hats. First, his hat as a witness to some of those important events, not only in 1963, but also 1962 in the Deep South in America. And second, a hat as a historian, to, with the benefit of 50 years later, to give us what some of those events signified and what their place in history is. So those are the two distinct hats, and they'll be woven together as we progress through the evening. Now, to transport us back 50 years, imagine in your mind the calendar rolling back one year after the other, rolling over 50 times until you come to rest in front of an old black and white TV, probably made by RCA or Zenith. No remote in those days, all black and white. And you want, and here are some of the news items and scenes that you would have seen 1963. This is 3 minutes of rolling yourself back to put yourself in the mood, so roll them.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. This afternoon, following a series of threats and defiant statements, the presence of Alabama National Guardsmen was required on the University of Alabama to carry out the final and unequivocal order of the United States District Court of the Northern District of Alabama.
I draw the line in the dust and toss the gauntlet before the feet of tyranny, and I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
You can never whip these boys if you don't keep you and them separate. I found that out in Birmingham. You've got to keep the white and the black separate.
I have a dream. One day, this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal.
I have the feeling that if we can get a breakthrough in Birmingham and really break down the walls of segregation, it will demonstrate to the whole South, at least the hardcore South, that it can no longer resist integration.
Now the time has come for this nation to fulfill its promise. The events in Birmingham and elsewhere have so increased the cries for equality that no city or state or legislative body can prudently choose to ignore them. Speak, I shall ask the Congress of the United States to act, to make a commitment it has not fully made in this century to the proposition that race has no place in American life or law.
The greatest leader of our time has been struck down by the foulest deed of our time. No words are strong enough to express our determination to continue the forward thrust of America that he began. Above all, the dream of equal rights for all Americans, whatever their race or color. And now the ideas and the ideals which he so nobly represented must and will be translated into effective action.
5 hours after the House passes the measure, the Civil Rights Act of 1964 is signed at the White House by President Johnson. Before an audience of legislators and civil rights leaders who had labored long and hard for passage of the bill, President Johnson calls for all Americans to back what he calls a turning point in history.
We must not approach the observance and enforcement of this law in a vengeful spirit. Its purpose is not to punish. Its purpose is not to divide, but to end divisions. Divisions which have lasted all too long.
Now, in this summer of 1964, the Civil Rights Bill is the law of the land. In the words of the President, it restricts no one's freedom so long as he respects the rights of others.
I want to thank Will McElhenney, who put that collection together, and also Robin Lipsky, who has helped organize this entire event. Those two especially, I ask that you give them a round of applause. The first question for our esteemed Judge Henderson, I need to do a short setup for this. It'll take just a few seconds. But it's because this is a history program, let's think about where 1963 fit in the earlier history of our country. For 300 years, there was slavery in America. Three centuries. In 1865, those of you who've seen the Lincoln movie or otherwise know your history, know that the 13th Amendment abolished slavery in this country. It was replaced by a system of segregation plus discrimination. And what most of us fail to remember is that almost all of that segregation and discrimination was legal. It was the law of the land, except with respect to precious few aspects. This went on for 80 years, eight decades, and created in this country a caste system of second-class citizens and abject poverty. And because of the discrimination, it was virtually impossible for those victims of segregation to escape. Now, the civil rights movement began before 1963, we all know that. But by 1963, the civil rights movement had spilled out of the court system and had gone into the streets. There were sit-ins, marches, boycotts, picketing. The NAACP itself was against what it called mass direct action of this type. The New York Times editorial page was against this type of direct mass action and favored the NAACP approach, which was litigation in the courts. So, with that background, Judge Henderson, and putting on your hat as a historian and looking back over these last 50 years, what would you say was the significance in history of the year 1963?
Very good question. I think it was a year when the civil rights movement came of age, when it got its chops, so to speak, when it put it all together and realized that demonstrations alone for a righteous cause will not get the movement where it wanted to go, that you had to have other ingredients. And this came about with Martin Luther King's experience at Albany, Georgia, the Albany movement, and his observation of the Freedom Rides. Albany went exactly the way they wanted. They demonstrated, they got local attention, it was peaceful, but they had a wily sheriff, Laurie Pritchard, who had done his homework and realized what King's objectives were, and he refused to give them the drama that King later realized you needed. And so he arrested them, it was peaceable, and the movement petered out. At the same time, King saw what happened with the Freedom Rides. We all picture the bloody John Lewis getting off the bus. We all know about the bloodied and unconscious, having a senior moment, the White House aide, who was also struck and knocked unconscious.
Siegenthaler.
And we saw the national drama there. That was on television all over the world and prompted President Kennedy to integrate interstate transportation at our bus stations and elsewhere. He put that together to realize that you needed the drama and you didn't need a Laurie Pritchard. You needed a fool as your opponent, and along comes Bull Connor. And it all came together with the fire hoses and the dogs and the cruelty and the combination of those two things to get international and national attention. He also was lucky, or the movement was lucky, I think, to have JFK as the president, because it was known from the start, or felt from the start, that we had a sympathetic president. It wasn't felt you had that in previous presidencies, and so the civil rights movement didn't have a lot of hope that anything they did would get the results they wanted. But with JFK, they did it, and it all came together in Birmingham, where they had Bull Connor ready with the dogs and the fire hoses, sweeping people across the park and under cars and down the street, and they realized that this was the way they were going to get their goals. And it was an interesting year. Started off slowly with George Wallace's Segregation Today, Tomorrow, and Forever speech. It was bumpy along the way. It started off slowly in February. Martin Luther King actually asked JFK to issue a new Emancipation Proclamation to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the original Emancipation Proclamation, and JFK refused to do that. We get to April, and the Birmingham campaign begins. Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth invited Martin Luther King and his Southern Christian Leadership Conference to come to Birmingham to try to integrate the downtown stores in Birmingham, so they combined their effort. It started slowly, and they were only using adults at this time, and they had several hundred adults. They got arrested, and the campaign was losing steam, And so Martin Luther King decided he needed to lead it and get arrested to invigorate the campaign. He did so. He was arrested. That gave it a little life. And it was during that arrest that he wrote his famous letter from a Birmingham jail. But the real spark that got Birmingham going was James Bevel was his lieutenant, a man that I think has never gotten his historic due. He was so important to these campaigns because he was sort of the street smart guy in Southern Christian Leadership Conference. He said, we need some kids, and he called it the children's campaign. There was a lot of resistance to this because they thought it was dangerous for kids, but Bevel had the sense to know that the reason they couldn't get many adults out was that every demonstration I ever went to during the time I was there, as soon as the movement left town, the adults who had gotten arrested lost their jobs, they were harassed, they were punished, so they were reluctant to go out in great numbers. The kids didn't have that. Plus, it was romantic to them. They were excited about getting out there and doing things. And Bevels would show them movies of the lunch counter demonstrations. They thought it was romantic. And so he was able to get 2,000 kids ranging in age from 6 to 18 who were going out and anxious to go out and get arrested and serve the cause. So this gave it the energy that led to a settlement of the Birmingham demonstration.
I want to come to where I'm getting ahead of ourselves because we got a few slides to show in a moment. But let me go back to one thing you said. And at the time George Wallace gave his segregation today, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever speech, how would you characterize the Kennedy administration's policy towards civil rights at that moment? That was in mid-January, 63.
Mid-January. Quite frankly, the policy was do as little as you have to do and no more to resolve the instant civil rights challenge. And Martin Luther King saw his job, or the movement, as to create bigger and bigger challenges and to get his involvement in solving the whole problem, the nationwide problem.
All right, we want to now put your hat on as a witness for a moment. I want to give a couple of accolades here to two people I hope that are in the audience. Abby Ginsberg, who did The Soul of Justice. This is the story of Judge Henderson's time in the Deep South. It's a wonderful film. And then The Oral History by Leah McGarrickle. I know she's here, I saw her earlier. And this is a legitimate oral history by the Bancroft Library. And it tells much of the same period, but also other parts of the life of Judge Henderson. I should back up and say The Soul of Justice also takes the biography up to the present. So we're going to retrace a little of that ground, but ask some different questions as well, and forgive me for some overlap with that, but there'll be a lot of new material here tonight. So the next question is, you were the first African-American ever to work in the Civil Rights Division in the Department of Justice.
Right.
All right, so we want you to just tell us briefly how you got that job. How did that come to you?
Sort of accidentally. I mean, I didn't look for the job. I didn't think there were jobs available for me there. But I was about to graduate from Bolt Hall, and this was a time in 62 when the world was different than it is now. And so the large law firms in the Bay Area, in the state for that matter, were not interviewing blacks. So I wasn't looking there. I thought that I would do what most blacks did. You find a successful black lawyer and you hitch on with him. He throws you a few cases to start your practice, and you built up your own practice. My only decision at that time was whether I would do that in L.A., where I grew up, or whether I would stay in the Bay Area. And I think I was probably leaning towards staying in the Bay Area, which I liked very much. It turned out that John Doerr, who became my boss at the Justice Department, had been going around government agencies at the behest of Bobby Kennedy, trying to push them, prod them, to integrate their staff. And he would go around and say, how many blacks do you have working for you? One day, one asked him, how many blacks do you have working for you? And through him, he said, oh, hadn't thought of that. My great fortune was that he was a Bolthall grad. And so he called Dean William Prosser and asked if there were any blacks graduating. There were two of us. And for some reason, Dean Prosser recommended me. I flew back, took the interview, and got the job.
And that was 1962.
That was 62, right.
So you got in your little Volkswagen and drove all the way across the country.
I did. I got in my little Volkswagen Bug with just about everything I owned.
And it was just you?
Just me.
All right.
Headed for Washington.
So let's say, just to focus on discrimination, segregation, public accommodations. Tell us what it was like for you going across the country trying to find a place to sleep at night.
Well, it was tricky. It was tricky. I knew enough to take the northern route which, to Washington. And it was experimental. And I learned as I went across country, I learned that it was not smart to start looking for a motel or hotel late in the evening because you very often didn't find one at that first stop. And so I would, as I went across, I would start looking earlier and earlier. And it was hit and miss. You would see a vacancy sign flashing, essentially saying, come on, we've got room, we need your money. And you'd go in there, and it was probably 50-50 as to whether they would say, oh, we have a room, or say, oh, gee, we don't have a room. And at that time, it wasn't prudent for me to say, but you have a sign out there. I would just leave and go until I found another place. And that's the way I made it across town. When I got to Chicago, I had gotten a little tired of this. And so I actually went into Chicago and stayed at a YMCA. But just sort of hit and miss across country till I got to Washington.
And when you got to Washington, where did you stay?
I found a room. An African-American woman, one of the fellows at the department, had told me that there was a woman who rented a room. And I went to her house and checked in and rented a room from her as a temporary measure. That wasn't intended to be permanent. I had about a three-week period that I knew I had to wait until my security clearance. And so that gave me 3 weeks to look for a place, and I eventually found a brand new apartment complex that had been built in the southwest section of Washington.
And that was an integrated facility?
That was an integrated facility, and that was, Washington was still largely a southern town then, but this was integrated and this was new for Washington and very nice place.
So at the DOJ, at the Justice Department, the Civil Rights Division was on what floor then?
I was on the first floor.
Right. So did you have an office, a cubicle? What was that situation?
Well, the heads of the departments had offices, single offices, but the attorneys, the new guys like myself, we had an office that was divided into four cubicles. and we had a little barrier. We could look over and sort of talk to each other. So
you get your first assignment out of town. Where was that?
I've often wondered whether that was coincidental or intentional. I was born in Shreveport, Louisiana, and lo and behold, my first assignment out of Washington was in Shreveport. It came a couple of months after I started. They were reluctant to send me out. They thought it was dangerous. They didn't know how dangerous, and they didn't know in what ways it was dangerous, but there was constant talk. They used the phrase, whether a black person in a position of authority could actually do this job down south. But finally, after training and a lot of discussions, they sent me off to Shreveport to work on a voting rights case.
Now, this was before the Voting Rights Act of 65.
Right.
So what was the voting rights provision that you were bringing those suits under?
It was a provision that our guideline for proving our case was to find a pattern and practice of discrimination. And so I don't remember after all of these years. It wasn't a Voting Rights Act. It was a provision which allowed the federal government to bring a suit against a political entity that displayed a pattern and practice of discrimination.
All right, so very quickly, you landed at the airport, right?
I landed at the airport.
And you were all alone?
I was alone.
And you were going to meet up eventually with someone named Frank Dunbaugh, is that right?
Frank Dunbaugh was the head of the Louisiana Division. The Civil Rights Division was divided into three states, Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama, and our focus was on voting rights. So Frank went down ahead and scouted the place for me to find living accommodations and lay the way for me, right.
So right there at the airport, didn't you have an interesting experience come face-to-face with Southern justice right off the bat?
I did, unintentionally. I was nervous about this first trip and got off the airplane, went and rented a car, got my car, and when I got my car, got in the car and started driving to Shreveport. It was about 10 o'clock at night. About 20 minutes down the freeway, I realized I hadn't picked up my luggage. That's how nervous I was. So and it was a big, wide, modern, a new freeway. And so I swung around and started heading back to the airport. In about 2 minutes, I saw a red light behind me and a siren, and I pulled over and later learned that this was a new superhighway they had built, and I thought it was two ways. And I was going back the wrong way on this one-way highway. So the highway patrolman pulled me over, and it was a very scary moment. I got out of the car, and he came up, had a gun, put the gun to my head and said, "Are you drunk, boy? You've been drinking?" And then the next question, blacks didn't carry weapons back then or guns, because he asked, "Did I have a knife or a razor?" He didn't seem to be interested in a gun. I didn't have either, and he eased up and we began talking, and he found out that I didn't tell him I was from the Justice Department, but I told him I was from California. He sort of softened up and said, "Oh, well, I know that area. I used to be on the Hayward Police Department." And we started talking about Berkeley and Hayward, and he eased up and he gave me a ticket. And I went back. I went back and got my luggage and went on to Shreveport.
We had the opportunity to go through some of Judge Henderson's papers for this, and you can see that he was cited for careless reckless. Now, they were covering all their bases. So there we are. So you caught up eventually with Frank Dunbow, correct?
Right.
All right, now you, this is, I find an amazing story, but where did he stay and what hotel did he stay at and where did you stay?
Frank, as I said, went on ahead. He was at a white hotel, if you were my color, one didn't stay at a white hotel, of course. And he found a place for me, an unlikely kind of place, a motel for colored, in the colored part of Shreveport. And he had scouted it out, and he drove me there. And we talked to the guy behind the desk, and said, we'd like a room. I'd like a room for my friend, with me being the friend. And he said, for how long? And we looked up, and we noticed that they rented rooms by the hour. I had planned to stay in town for about 10 days, and I think this guy had never had anybody who rented a room more than a few hours or a half a day. And the thing I remember, I got per diem was $25 a day. And one of the great things about this job, when I went to towns like Shreveport or even Birmingham or Jackson, I couldn't spend $25 a day if I went crazy. There's nothing for me to do. No place that charged more than a couple of bucks to eat at the fanciest place I could eat at. But anyway, so Frank said, and I don't remember after all these years, but I'll make up the time. Let's say the room cost $10 a night if you added up the hours. So Frank said, well, how much stuff for 10 days? And the guy thought, and I think the figure was too big for him, and assuming it was $10 a night, he thought of the biggest number he could and said, well, that's going to cost you at least $45. So I pulled out, gave him $45, and that's where I stayed for the 10 days.
Now, at that time...
Very busy motel, too.
So in those days, did that violate any laws to have colored only motel and a white only motel? Was that legal?
It was perfectly legal, yeah. And that was the way of life down there. That's the way it was done. Perfectly legal.
And you told us a story about going, on this trip, you also went to New Orleans and had the opportunity to go to a place called, or at least the outside of Preservation Hall.
Right.
Tell us that story and how it came to be that you were in New Orleans.
We were in New Orleans, Frank and I and Sandy Ross, another member of the department, working on a voting rights case, getting it ready for John Doerr to try. And one night, a hot summer night, we wanted to go out. It was 9:30, 10-ish, and we wanted to go out for break and to eat. And the federal courthouse was right around the corner from Bourbon, whatever street Preservation Hall was on. So we found ourselves walking down the street, and it had these half doors open, wooden doors open, and you could hear this great music coming out. And I had heard the Preservation Hall jazz band at Stanford. When I worked there as assistant dean, they would come, the Frost Amphitheater, and I would listen to them each year they came. So we stood outside listening to this wonderful music. There were two guys at the door. And again, there are a lot of people from Berkeley, I'm realizing, because one of the doormen was from Berkeley. And we got into a nice, friendly chat, and very friendly about what brought him to New Orleans, and what I was doing here, what we were doing here. We didn't tell him we were working on a voting rights case to sue. But after about 10 minutes of listening, we thought, this is fun. Let's go in here and listen to music and eat in here. And to my utter astonishment, given this friendly thing, the guy said, oh, you can't go in here. And it was segregated. And it sort of gave me this sense of unreality. It was surreal to have these guys who were friendly. It wasn't hostile. This was just the rule. Blacks could not go in there and watch this black band play.
And as the laws existed then, now, this is before the Civil Rights Act, that perfectly legal as well?
That was perfectly legal, and that's the way it was done, yes.
So did you, going back to Shreveport for a moment, did you have an occasion to find out who your namesake was?
I did. As I said, I was born in Shreveport, and my mother, when she was waiting to give birth, was in this small rural hospital, and she tells me that in those days, I don't know quite what they do now, but they gave you some sort of drug that relaxed you and made you a little woozy and lightheaded, and she was waiting to give birth. And her attendant was a white nurse, a very friendly woman, according to my mother. And she asked my mother what she was going to name me. And my mother said, Eugene, after his father. And the nurse said, oh, you know, I think Thelton is a pretty name. And my mother said, Thelton, and name me Thelton. That's the true story. And over the years, I've never met another Thelton. I doubt if any of you have. But when I went to Shreveport for this case and stayed at this by-the-hour hotel, I was working on a voting rights case. And the way we would do it, the FBI, we'd have the FBI photograph all of the voting records, and you'd have a long list of white registered voters, and you'd have a very, very short list of white unregistered voters, a very, very short list of registered black voters, and a very long list of unregistered black voters, and you would study those. You'd note, for example, that a few dozen of the unregistered black voters were actually had master's degrees from Tuskegee or a local black college, and they couldn't pass the voting rights test. And very many of the white voters had third grade educations, and they managed to pass that same test. And that's the way you established your pattern and practice of discrimination. So here I was going through these records, and I come upon a white policeman named Thelton. Little research with my mother, I'm convinced that I was named after a white cop in Shreveport.
Birmingham. Let's turn to Birmingham. This is what you mentioned earlier when we started. Now, when you were assigned to go to Birmingham, that was your second big out-of-town project.
Right.
All right. And when what was your assignment when you were sent down by the Justice Department to Birmingham?
When I was first sent down, it was to work on a voting rights case that we were preparing for Birmingham, for that county.
Now, where did you stay motel-wise in Birmingham?
No, that one was easy. There was one black hotel, motel, to stay in. That's where Martin Luther King stayed. That's where all the civil rights people stayed. It was the A.G. Gaston Motel, a place that was owned by a black millionaire, A.G. Gaston, who was an insurance man. He had all the black insurance business in the area. And this was a place we all stayed.
So, and did Martin Luther King stay there as well?
Yeah, he stayed there as well. Andy Young, a lot of the white sympathizers with the civil rights movement, and most of the white press, New York Times. There's a fellow named Claude Sitton, who at the time wrote for the New York Times, would stay there. Yeah.
We have up on the screen a picture of the A.G. Gaston, at least part of it there.
Mm-hmm.
Do you recognize any part of that as showing the room you were in?
Oh, yeah. I would usually stay on that second landing up there. About two-thirds of the way back was generally, I didn't have a room, but it was either a couple of rooms along there that I got in the habit of asking for, and if they were available, that's where I stayed.
And where did Dr. King stay?
Dr. King stayed farther up this way, but also on that second balcony, because he held press conferences there, and press would be full of people whenever it was announced that he was going to give a speech or make an announcement. So it was easier to do it from the second, from the balcony, so he was always up there.
Now, did you have occasion to meet Dr. King?
Oh, many, many occasions, yeah.
How did that come about?
Well, we were there at the motel. The movement was there. James Bevel, Andy Young, C.T. Vivian, Wyatt T. Walker. They would all stay at the hotel. And there were quiet moments when you're in. You'd find yourself in the restaurant, or just standing out in the courtyard there, or just hanging out. And they were curious about me, and I didn't want to be a mysterious kind of person, so I would go up and start talking and introducing myself. And it wasn't long before everybody knew that I was that black guy from the Justice Department. And so we became friends, and I think probably the smartest thing I ever did was one day standing out there on a hot day and we were eating ice cream cones. I told King and Andy Young, you know, you shouldn't tell me anything that you don't want Bobby Kennedy to know, because that's part of my job. And I think everything got fine then. They were a little worried about me, whether I was some sort of mole or just what I did. And when I leveled with them like that, we got along quite well. And indeed, part of my job was to be a liaison between them and Bobby Kennedy. And I think, I very strongly suspect, they used that to their advantage by telling me things that they wanted Bobby Kennedy to know.
And did it work the other way, where Bobby Kennedy or John Doerr or Burke Marshall would pass information on to you with the expectation that you would provide that to King?
No, never. Never,
so
never
one went way.
The other way. One way.
One way. All right. So you said earlier about the there had been the Albany experience, by Albany, Georgia, not New York,
right,
with the Sheriff Laurie Pritchard, who had allowed the demonstrations to go forward. It never got on the front page. And then Birmingham started. But was Birmingham a big success for the civil rights movement from the get-go, or did that take time?
No, it took time. It was, it started very slowly. As I said, they had adults, and they were still experimenting and starting to learn what to do. What they knew they wanted was something dramatic that would get in the national press. And early on, the press wasn't even there. The press started coming as things started heating up. But at first it was orderly. Kids would meet at the 16th Street, or the adults would meet at the 16th Street Baptist Church, talk for a little while, and then Bevels would say, okay, it's whatever time, go on out and head for downtown area. The goal wasn't to really get to the downtown area, but the goal was to get arrested in some way trying to get down to the downtown area. And the arrests initially were very routine, not much happening. And as I said, after they exhausted the adults that they could get to come do it, it wasn't until they got the Children's Crusade and got these hundreds of children that things heated up, and it really heated up and got to the point where Bull Connor pulled out the hoses and the police dogs. When they had so many kids that they could strategize, they would send one group of kids, 25 to 50, out and head this way, and the police would hear about it, and they'd be marshaled there, and then they'd send another out this way, and they were outwitting Bull Connor in terms of making the arrest. And that's when he resorted to the violence.
The Kelly Ingram Park, where was that in relationship to these, the fire hoses and the attack dogs?
Kelly Ingram Park was very near the A.G. Gaston Motel. It was sort of the symbolic border between the white part of town and the black part of town. It was largely a black park, but it was a public park. It's where the blacks hung out, and sort of on this side was the white part of town. On this side was the black part of town.
So the marches would go from where to where?
They would go out of out of the 16th Street Baptist Church, invariably would go through Kelly Ingram Park. And some of those pictures you saw of fire hoses, there were a couple where you'd see kids holding on to trees. Those were trees in Kelly Ingram Park.
And were you there?
I was there, yeah.
And so describe to us what you saw.
Well, I wasn't holding on to trees. I had good eyesight. And so I was standing back out of the fire, out of the line of fire for the fire hoses, and observing. That was part of my job. I was looking for reportable civil rights demonstrations. But another thing I was looking for was the aftermath of these, because one of the things that the Kennedys wanted to know was, is violence going to erupt? And if so, how is it going to do it? And I think they were more interested in whether the blacks were going to engage in violence against the whites, which would then accelerate. And I learned over the course of my job that one of the triggers for the president doing something was if there was going to be some black violence in retaliation. For example, that presented itself most prominently after the church was bombed and the four little girls were killed. At that point, blacks were arming themselves and really going around, and there were some rumors that blacks had dynamite and they were going to start bombing. And then things got quite tense, and the president got the National Guard, and I forget the nearby base had soldiers on alert from a nearby base to come in. That's when it really got tense.
That was in September 63, when the church was bombed.
That's right.
But to go back to Kelly Ingram Park for just a moment, that was still in May.
That was in May.
And that was before the president announced that he was going to submit a civil rights bill.
That's right. That was in June that the president made that announcement. But this was part of that buildup as it got more and more intense, and as Bull Connor did more and more of what Martin Luther King wanted him to do, so that it was an international incident.
So describe for us how that succeeded in helping turn the country around on the issue of civil rights.
Well, it succeeded because, again, Martin Luther King's goal was to have some dramatic event which showed to the country what the South was really like, instead of, you know, lazy plantations or no colored signs and blacks drinking from white fountains. He wanted to show the violent nature of it to get on the front pages of the newspaper to indicate to the country and indeed to the world what conditions blacks in the South were living under. And this contributed to it because this is what the press was there for. They would get up every morning, and I was sort of a minor celebrity because they knew I was sort of in on a lot of the things, and so I could have had coffee all day long from the reporters. Say, Thelton, let's go have a cup of coffee and talk, trying to figure out what was going on so that it could get a scoop for the papers. So the hose was exactly what King wanted, and it was just the opposite of Albany. That's why I mentioned that nothing there was going to get on the papers or get the attention. So this is what, when I started my comments at the start and saying the civil rights movement came of age because they learned what kinds of things would provoke the kind of attention that would get on the front page and would therefore get the interest and the involvement of the President of the United States and the federal government.
I want to come to the president's speech in a moment, but let's go now to Jackson, Mississippi, my hometown. Mm-hmm. And your next assignment was to go to Jackson.
Right.
So what was your assignment there?
Again, my assignment was to meet Medgar Evers. He was the head of the local NAACP, and he had a very vigorous voting rights drive going. It's interesting to differentiate between Jackson and Birmingham. Birmingham was driven by Martin Luther King, the Southern Christian Leadership Council, and Reverend Shuttlesworth's group. And they believed in direct action, nonviolent direct action of the kind that I've described. The NAACP was much different from that. They didn't believe, they disapproved of nonviolent direct action. Their history was born of Charles Hamilton Houston and Thurgood Marshall to make their points there to advance civil rights through legal actions, through lawsuits. And once you got the lawsuits, the other part of the organization would then lobby for laws to enforce, for legislation to enforce the laws that came out of the lawsuit. So Medgar Evers wasn't engaging in direct action as Martin Luther King referred to that. He was involved with voting rights and also boycotts, which were not illegal if done properly, if you got a permit in Birmingham. Anyway, so I was there.
You're saying that the national NAACP favored litigation and it was against direct action.
That's correct.
And Medgar Evers was the field secretary for the NAACP in Jackson. Mm-hmm. But it did turn out that in May and June of 1963, there were similar demonstrations and picketing and sit-ins going on in Jackson that Medgar Evers was involved with.
Yeah.
So how did it come about that he was able to get around the national prohibition, the national organization's disfavor of those kind of direct actions?
Well, Medgar was chafing at the bit all the time. He wanted to do much more. I think personally, Medgar favored what was going on in Birmingham and what SNCC and CORE and others were doing. But every time he would sort of venture out, Roy Wilkins would send someone down there to rein him back in. But he was always testing the waters. He wanted to do more, and I think these demonstrations that you referred to were his act of rebellion against the NAACP, and I've always figured that had he not been assassinated a couple of months later, he might have bolted the NAACP and not join another, but start his own organization.
So a couple of things that I know you did down there. One was the you were assigned to go check out the Fairgrounds jailhouse.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us how that came about and why there even was a Fairgrounds jailhouse.
A lot of blacks were being arrested in these demonstrations that Medgar organized, and they actually filled up the jails. They had so many. By then, they were having kids coming out, so they had plenty of ammunition, if you will. And they filled up the jails, and the kids kept coming. And so they opened up the county, I think it was the county, fairgrounds, and barbed wired it and started putting the kids in the fairgrounds, jailing them. And I got a call, the Medgar and the other civil rights leaders in Jackson were complaining to the White House about the treatment of the kids. For example, they were carrying them to jail in garbage trucks. I mean, they were just using whatever means to transport them. And I was asked to go down and look at the jail and visit it and see if there were any complaints or any inhumane treatment of the civil rights demonstrators. So I made the arrangements and I went down to visit. And I was pretty naive about the ways of the press at that time. And so when I went in, they gave me a tour. The sheriff and others on his staff gave me a tour first of the kitchen. And it had a big, huge grill that was shiny, and the kitchen was spick and span. And the sheriff said, how does that look for cleanliness? Because one of the complaints was the cleanliness and sanitation. And I very naively said, looks mighty fine to me. And went along the tour of the jail for about maybe a half an hour. The next day, I got you would remember the
Clarion Ledger.
Huh?
The Clarion Ledger.
Clarion Ledger, okay. I got a copy of the Clarion Ledger, and there is Thelton Henderson on the front page with the caption, looks mighty fine to me, says young, not young, but says Federal attorney. So I learned another lesson about how the world works.
Mm-hmm. So you told us also the story about Roy Wilkins, the head of the NAACP in New York, finally decided that it was time to do some direct action.
Yeah.
So, and he came to Jackson. So tell us that story and also your role in that story.
Okay. Yeah, he, as you said, he decided the NAACP was getting badly left behind. King, Roy Wilkins, and was quite jealous, I think it's fair to say, of King. King was increasingly being seen as the leader of the civil rights movement, displacing the old old-timers like Wilkins and the NAACP. And he thought he had to do something about it, and the thing to do was to get arrested. So he arranged to fly down to Jackson and picket the Woolworth store on
Capitol Street.
And so I was asked to go down there and observe that arrest. When I drove there at the appointed time, it was going to be staged. He was going to walk back and forth along with Medgar Evers, and the sheriff was going to come along and arrest him. I got there, and there were so many people there to see it that I couldn't park the way I had planned. I had to park a couple of blocks away, and I parked. I jumped out of my car. I was rushing down the side street to get to Capitol and Woolworth, and there were black kids handing out leaflets about the demonstration. And so, again, as part of my job, I was taking the leaflets and holding them in my hand and walking and trying to hurry to the corner when all of a sudden a couple of cops jumped out and arrested me for distributing leaflets. I never got to see Roy Wilkins get arrested. They took me in a paddy wagon and kept me in there for about a half an hour, drove me away. And then when I got down to the police station, I showed them my credentials and they let me go, but I missed the whole thing.
June 11th, when these events were still going on in Jackson, President Kennedy decided to submit a civil rights bill to Congress. And those of you out there who've read this history know that he decided it on the spur of the moment, and one day it didn't have the civil rights bill even written, and he was advised not to do it. It was the day that the University of Alabama was peacefully integrated, although marshals were there, just in case. And so on June 11th, the president decided, I'm going to go on TV tonight, and he asked Ted Sorensen, write the speech. And they were writing the speech up to 2 minutes before he went on the air that evening. So that was the speech. Did you see the speech?
Yes, I saw the speech.
And what did you think at the time you saw the speech?
I thought it was wonderful. It was a huge surprise to me. I don't know why I say that. I hadn't expected the speech because I know that King had been asking him to pass a bill and make a speech and say something and give moral leadership was the way he saw it to the president. So I didn't see it coming, nor did King for that matter, but it was a wonderful speech. It was inspiring. I thought it answered everything that the civil rights leaders had hoped for in him. Remember I said that when he came into office, he gave the movement hope because they saw in him someone who would listen and, if properly presented with something, would respond to the right situation. And this culminated in that response.
So 4 hours later in Jackson, Medgar Evers was getting out near midnight, getting out of his car, walking to his front door, and was killed by a sniper.
Right.
Do you remember that?
Oh, I remember it all too clearly. I had been with Medgar the day before and had gone back to Washington, D.C. and read about it. I can't remember whether I read about it or saw it on TV, but yes, I remember it vividly.
Did you go back for the funeral?
I did. I flew back for the funeral and spent several days there following the funeral.
Tell us that story about the impromptu protest march that started out from the church and was heading downtown and John Doerr and you, did you remember that story?
Oh, gosh.
Please tell us that one.
Yeah, after the funeral, it was a huge crowd for the funeral. And after the funeral, there were no plans for anything that I was aware of, but some SNCC workers, they were very angry, very upset about Medgar Evers' death. They decided in an impromptu fashion that they were going to march down to, can't remember whether it was City Hall or the State Capitol, which was near there. And so I was with them, and we were going along. I was in the front of the crowd walking with the SNCC people that I had come to know. And we looked up the street, and there were the police lined up blocking the way. And it reminded me very, very much some years later of a demonstration in Berkeley, where Berkeley students were going to walk toward Oakland down College, which is near where I live now, and the Oakland police were lined up at the border. I mean, it was very similar. But anyway, as they got perhaps, I'd say from here to the back of the auditorium, with police, all of a sudden I remembered that the locals had told me that the police have a reputation on these kinds of demonstrations of firing warning shots at waist level, was the way they put it. And there I was in the front of this crowd, and I thought, this is not the place to be. So I started moving back into the crowd, and as I did so, there was a sudden hush, and I could hear a voice, and I looked up, and there was John Doerr, tall, tall sort of John Wayne kind of a build, saying, "Stop, this will get you nowhere. You've got to trust me. My name is John Doerr," and we've always kidded him since to this day because he spelled his name, D-O-A-R, as if that mattered. But he stopped what I'm convinced would have been a slaughter, that these people, there would have been deaths. And he had the foresight and the bravery to step out into the middle of that. And he had the credibility with the civil rights workers because they cooperated with him. Even the SNCC people backed off. And I think they were trying to foment some trouble.
We have that famous picture of John Doerr up there, and I think in the background you can see the police lined up just like you described them.
Right, they were lined up there, and he came out of that crowd, and just like you see it, stopped the what was going to be a riot.
SNCC, for the young people in the audience, meant
Nonviolent Coordinating Committee.
All right. Let's change subject for a moment and talk about the FBI. J. Edgar Hoover was still alive then.
Right.
Very much alive. So you would think if someone like you down there and also civil rights workers down there could count on the protection by the FBI. But was that really true, and what was the attitude of the FBI in those days?
You would think it, but it it was not the reality. There are many possible explanations. One is that the FBI civil rights was not high on their crime-solving agenda or investigating agenda, and they preferred, and most of them were Southerners, they preferred to maintain their relationships with law enforcement, police, sheriffs, and everyone. So they didn't enthusiastically enforce or investigate civil rights. And I think that it's clear to me that Hoover had a real antipathy against Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement. So they were not seen by the movement as friends, and they were not, if there was danger, they didn't look to the FBI to help the movement in any way.
Were there any African Americans in the FBI at that time?
Not to my knowledge, no.
You told us a story about the, that illustrates the way the FBI worked then. And you were also in Selma at one point during 1963, and the FBI was filming a voting rights demonstration. Oh, tell us that story and the point of that story.
Okay, I was in Selma on a big voting rights day. It was a huge day in Selma, and blacks from all over the area, Dallas County, were going down to the county courthouse to register to vote. I was there with a fellow named Dick Wasserstrom, who was a UCLA law professor who, I don't know if he took a leave or retired from that to join the department. He was very committed to civil rights. And we were down there observing the voting rights, the registration day. And the sheriff or the county had decided to slow down the registration. It started at 8 o'clock, I believe. And so they rallied a lot of the unregistered whites in town, and they were coming in a back door registering. They had their own voting rights day, and it was in the 90 degrees. Blacks, many of them were dressed up and had hats on and were waiting, and by 10 o'clock, only about four blacks had even gotten in to try to register, and they had hundreds of people lined up blocks away, and it was clear that it was a slowdown, and that even if it went all day at that rate, you might get 20 or 30 blacks who would be able to take the test. But anyway, there were some young people there, SNCC, members who decided that they were going to bring refreshments to the blacks. It was hot, and the sheriff, Jim Clark, I believe, was the sheriff, had said that anybody who got out of, we had gotten an injunction against him interfering with the voting rights effort. He interpreted that to mean that nobody could interfere, and that if people got out of line to go to the bathroom, they not only couldn't get back in line where they got out, nor could they get in line at the end of the line. They couldn't even participate in it that day. They had withdrawn from the voting process. So these kids, I saw them get instructions. They had a box top that was cut off, a lot of cups in there, and they poured orange soda pop and some sort of ginger ale and water, and had, I don't know, 30, 40 cups in there that they headed across the street to give to the people in line. And Dick and I instructed the FBI to take a picture of this because we expected violence.
A film, was it? It was a film, right?
It was a film, yeah, a film. Yeah, to film it, yeah. Mm-hmm. We asked him to film it. When we saw the film, And I should add that they had deputized a lot of local citizens, literally local thugs, and they were across the street. So when these kids were walking across the street with the drinks, the FBI caught them, and then you saw some of the deputized people approach. And we saw it, and they beat the crap out of them, if you'll excuse the phrase. But before you saw a blow, the film went off and started filming the windows of the county building, and it was never caught. And that was not atypical of the way they did these things.
March on Washington, were you there for that?
I was not. I was in town, but for reasons that I've never known, they decided I knew too many of the participants from these experiences we've been talking about. They sent me out of town. I think they didn't want me mingling with them or to give an appearance or something that they didn't want.
Even after the president had submitted the civil rights bill to Congress, what was his view on the March on Washington?
Oh, he didn't want it. He tried. Burke Marshall and the president and the attorney general tried numerous times to discourage them from doing the March on Washington, but they insisted on it. It was one time when all of the civil rights groups, although they were not publicly, but behind the scenes, they were at war with each other. Wilkin didn't like King. SNCC was jealous of King because he was the emerging star. But for the March on Washington, A. Philip Randolph and the others, they bonded on that, and they insisted that it go forth. And so it did.
And it wound up being completely peaceful.
It wound up being peaceful. It wound up being fabulously successful. And again, that's why I was saying earlier, 1963 was a wonderful year. It all sort of came together, and I think they learned how to get these things done and to organize and not have random efforts. It was fabulously successful.
November 22, 1963, Dallas, Texas. President Kennedy was assassinated. And we could spend a lot of time on where we each were on that day, but let's pause over that and let me ask you a different question, and that is, what was the importance of the president's death in ultimately getting the civil rights bill enacted, admittedly in 1964, but it enacted?
Yeah. Well, let me say first, of course, that it was a great tragedy that, you know, still gets at all of us who go back that far. The legacy of a part of the civil rights legacy of that, however, was that it gave impetus, I believe, to the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It was not a certainty that it would go through before the assassination. He was going to push it. He had committed to it. It was going to be a battle. I think that it was not even a battle after his assassination. The respect and all of his memory, I think a lot of people voted for it and caused it to pass.
If he had not proposed the civil rights bill when he did and was going to wait on it, mm-hmm. and then he was assassinated, what do you think would have happened then in terms of passage of the act?
It's only a guess, but I think Lyndon Johnson was committed to a civil rights bill, and I think he had the savvy, the credentials, the know-how to get it, and I think he would have gotten a civil rights bill passed in JFK's memory, if nothing else.
We come to our last sequence of questions. This is the report card. So I'm going to ask Judge Henderson to comment on and give a grade to our nation on how we've done in five areas. And you can be thinking about what grade you would give too. So the first area for the report card is voting rights.
Okay. And the grade is how we're doing, how we've done.
Well, you can, however you want to do it, you know, before the recent Supreme Court decision, after the Supreme Court decision.
Okay, after the Supreme Court decision, I would say a B. It probably would have been a B plus before that. The recent setbacks are disturbing, and I don't know where they will go. But I think that when you take into account that when I started working for the Civil Rights Division, just a minuscule number of blacks were registered voters in the southern states, and that's what our job was. And when you think that progress in voting rights is such that we have a black president, we have black mayor in Birmingham, a town I could only find one place to live in, I think the Voting Rights Act has been largely a success.
Public accommodations.
I'd say a B plus. I think that there may be an A. I think we can, in the South, you can pretty much go where you want in public accommodations. You can go to the swimming pool. You can go to the department stores. You can eat at the lunch counter. You can drink from any fountain. You can ride in the front of the bus. I'd say it's probably an A.
Okay. Employment.
D plus, C minus. Because it's not just jobs, it's meaningful jobs, and I think it's very significant that people of color are still at the bottom of the economic ladder in this country, and I think that's a function of employment. We haven't been successful in getting what I would call a fair share of the better jobs, and so many of them are subsistence jobs, but it's, I'd say a low grade on that.
Housing
a B. I think we have we've done well on housing. In fact, probably just pure housing, B plus or A minus. I'm a tough grader. I don't give many A's, straight A's. But housing is a function, in my view, of employment. If you tie that in with that lower grade on, because I think there aren't many barriers to buying a house where you can afford to buy a house, but that's the key. And so people of color are limited to certain neighborhoods more by economics of their condition than by discrimination.
Finally, education.
Education has been a huge disappointment, a D. The promise of Brown versus Board of Education has never been realized, in my view. Our schools are still as segregated as they were when Brown versus Board was passed. Not by official segregation. You were talking earlier about the segregation I saw down there, and you said, was it legal? It was. Discrimination in the schools is no longer legal. But again, economic conditions and other things leave our schools as segregated as they ever were.
We don't have time, I'm afraid, for questions. Please join me in thanking Judge Henderson.
Thank you. Great question. Thank you.